Hello, and today we are with Dennis Keller, who's the Chief Business Officer of Siam Seaplane here in Thailand. Good morning to you, Dennis.
Good morning. Pleasure to be here.
It is great to see you again, because the last time we did an interview was, I think, 3 years ago at the Pattaya Boat Show at that time. Here we are at the Thailand Yacht Show in Pattaya, the first edition of the TYS 2022. How's the show going for you so far?
So far, it's been a good show. Again, nice to be back here after a few years. A lot of things have changed, and so this time we're here again to meet partners, to meet relevant and interesting people, to see what's going on, and of course to see how more and more now things are opening again, things are coming back to life. And I think just that is really, really nice to see, that business is slowly starting to flourish again.
The last time we spoke, CMC plane was about to take off. It wasn't far from taking off. Where are we now with CMC plane? What exactly is happening?
Yeah, very good question. Things have changed a little bit over the last few years. We all know that. What has not changed is our vision and our plans, meaning back then when we spoke, we were at the beginning of the company, we were at the beginning of validating the concept, of looking at partners, of having started the work with the regulator. Then COVID came, and COVID changed things. COVID meant for many things to pause, for many things to be delayed. For us, this meant that we could focus heavily internally on working on a lot of the regulatory components that we needed to put in place, on ensuring that the right relationships and processes are there. So we put a lot of this effort over the last couple of years in ensuring that we can proceed. And I think we've progressed really well throughout that time. Of course, if it hadn't been for COVID, it probably would have looked all a little bit different. But what I can say is that I'm really proud that throughout COVID, when many businesses suffered and many businesses went out of business, when many companies went bankrupt and struggled to survive, that we were able to push. We were able to push for our vision. We were able to keep hiring people into the team and to essentially grow, to ensure that we're getting closer and closer to our launch and to finally being able to be in the sky and to be able to land on the water. So now we're looking at a kind of ramp up phase that gets us closer to launch. Again, it is difficult always to say an exact date on when can we start, but I'm very happy to say we're at the final stages when it comes to our processes right now.
What is the target date, or at least the target quarter or target half of which year? Where exactly are you hoping to take off?
At the moment, we are looking at the end of this year. I hope there is no new pandemic surprises or things that are outside of our control that would change that. So this is the target we're working to at the moment.
You mentioned the regulations and the regulatory framework, licenses and everything. Are they now all in place? Do you have all the required licenses, or are there still things that need to be done in that sense?
There's things that need to be done, and the easiest way to look at it is once the licenses are there, the day after we start flying. And so this is what has been the what has been holding us from being able to be in the air. We are very, we've progressed very well in terms of the other components of the company. So for instance, on the commercial side, we've established over 40 partnerships with luxury resorts across Thailand. We have fantastic partners and buy-in across the board. And so again, this has been the work we've been able to put in place over the COVID time, to ensure that all the different components are sort of set and ready to go, pending a few of the remaining licensing processes?
The time since we last spoke, the 2 to 3 years that has passed, a lot has changed in terms of technology, but also in terms of people's sustainable needs and desires. Has this changed your plans in any way? Because more and more we're looking at electric aircraft, we're looking at more sustainable options. How is the new technology that is coming along, how is that changing your plans as a company?
You mentioned a few interesting topics. Number one, sustainability. What we've seen in COVID time now is that for us to not only reiterate our sustainability plans, but to make that very much core in the philosophy of the company. This also was corroborated through some of our shareholders and investors that came on board that really are strengthening, let's say, the sustainability element. And so we have a three-plan roadmap on sustainability, which overarching we call it sustainable by design. So to say it's not only an afterthought, it's not only a small component of the company, but it's rather a key milestone or a key cornerstone of what we're doing at Siam Seaplane. And so number one, it starts quite simple, and this is carbon compensation. Carbon compensation may sound easy in some cases, but it requires accurate tracking of carbon emissions. It requires accurate auditing that these tracking methodologies are accurate, and then working with the right local partners to really compensate for the emissions that are put in place. With that, it's also important to say that compared to most other transportation methods for the routes and the locations we're looking at, we are already by default much more environmentally friendly and a much better alternative in terms of carbon and in terms of general environmental impact. The second step for us is sustainable aviation fuels, and we believe that that is more readily available compared to electrification. But then we're looking at the third step, and that is, as you also mentioned, electrification. And here we see various options that are currently being explored. Number one would be full retrofitting of the engine, which could provide us with full electric aircraft. This we believe may be anywhere from 5 to 8 years away to be commercially viable. We see at the moment there's flights of about half an hour on fully electric aircraft. This just isn't enough to make it viable yet. We also see technologies such as with hydrogen, and so this is where we keep an open mind, where we are willing and active to participate in the R&D effort and see how we can implement that sensibly. That's the sustainability. You mentioned a little bit about the changes in general as well, and what we see here that's worthwhile to mention perhaps just briefly is two things. One, technology in general. And so again, we look at this as being a company that's, we say, digitally native, right? So anything from the back end of the operations through to the customer facing side of things, it's all about having the right technology in place. So if you Google us now, for instance, you will see that we already have an app. And that app already gives you some indications of our service that's to come. It gives you an idea about the sustainability components. It gives you facts and figures about seaplanes and their safety and how they operate. But it also gives you a glimpse of, for instance, all of our hotel partners. And so we already promote some of them. We promote certain experiences with our partners to sort of build up a little bit, you know, what's to come. So technology really is at the heart of everything, and it has to be at the heart of everything also to run an efficient and an effective company. And I think the last point to mention, the changes we've seen and what's changed a bit our outlook on the service that we are going to offer is, particularly with COVID, people now want more private and safe spaces. And so this certainly translates into the transport sector as well. Where we saw during COVID that private jet travel actually surged. The demand for private jets went through the roof, which was not to be expected perhaps before that. And so now being able soon to offer small aircraft of up to, you know, a capacity of up to 8 people is a very nice, you know, private space offering for people that are concerned about these sorts of things. And so this is a bit how we've also adapted our plans, we've adapted our priorities in some way, and we see that, if anything, the COVID period has validated further the need for the service that we're working on.
Yeah. Dennis, where are we in terms of fleet at the moment for Siam Seaplane? How many aircraft do you actually currently have? And what plans do you have for expansion of the fleet?
Yeah. So again, I think similar to what we spoke about in the early days, we are looking at starting with three aircraft. And this, we will bring the aircraft to Thailand as soon as, from a licensing perspective, we're ready to do so. I think you and maybe many of the listeners will know that grounded aircraft is the worst kind. Then we just sit on cost and can't do anything with it. And that's something we avoid, and manage this very closely with the regulator, with the Civil Aviation Authority and other associated partners, to make sure we do this very timely and efficiently, to save costs, but also to have, of course, enough time to plan for the launch properly.
Have you started contracting with OTAs and working with GDS systems and everything like that? Where are we in that sense in terms of distribution?
Distribution for us taps into a lot of our hotel partners. So we see a lot of mutual value add as we talk to hotel owners and hotel managers. We also, of course, talk with destination management companies, with some of the travel agencies. So there's some good relationships that exist. This will be solidified as we're getting closer to starting concrete flights and packages. Similarly, you mentioned GDS, Global Distribution Systems. Here we are somewhat selective in the beginning, primarily because we offer initially very tailored flights and charter services, but there will be some routes that are, let's say, predictable, you know, open flights to the public. And this is, of course, where it will be fantastic to be on you know, the sort of Google flights and Skyscanners and trip.com and so on. And these are things we are pursuing, again, as part also of saying how technology for us plays a very important role.
You mentioned routes there. Which would you envisage the routes, the initial routes? Where would they be to and from, are you expecting?
So in terms of routes, again, things are quite similar to what we looked at the beginning, and perhaps for some that have seen my interview a couple years ago at this very same location, I talked about how we're starting in the Gulf of Thailand. We're starting from Bangkok with surroundings that includes the Ocean Marina, that includes locations like Hua Hin, Prachuap, but of course also further east, for instance, Kokud. Another location that's very relevant here and has to be mentioned is, of course, the islands in around Samui. And so these are some of the initial locations, but we also have a very active eye on Phuket and the south. And so I can't reveal too much about the locations there at the moment, but suffice to say, if anything, we see an increasing demand in the south and from Phuket. And so this is something that we're very aware of and that we'll be adjusting based on the demand and the commercial setup that we will have.
Excellent. Well, Dennis, I have to say thank you very much indeed for providing us with an update on what's happening at Siam Seaplane at the moment. And I look forward to speaking to you again in the future when we get a bit closer to takeoff. But for now, thank you very much. And I wish you and everyone at Siam Seaplane the best of luck for the future. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Very much appreciated, and hope to speak soon.